Thank you, Bonnie. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Would you please rise with me as we sing our praise songs? The first one is Lord of the Dance, if you either want to follow along on the screen or take your red hymnal. It's page 261. Standing for the call to worship.
Good morning. Happy Easter. I hope you're having a blessed day today. I'm Sherry Schabelsky, and I'll be your liturgist today. Please read responsively. God of mystery, God of wonder and new life, last night we wept because we thought you were dead.
This morning,
but you have awakened us with sunshine, opening our eyes to daffodils and cherry blossoms, filling our ears with birdsong, and filling our hearts with joy.
For you are not dead, and risen, and live among us now.
Right.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Amen.
Please remain standing and join us in the singing of our first hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today, found on page 302. Be seated, and at this time I'd ask the children to come forward for children's time.
My goodness, what a polished and happy-looking group today. How many people here already had chocolate this morning? Yes. Easter's great, isn't it? One of the things that I have noticed about church in general and Easter for a special amount is that the grown-ups always do the talking. Have you guys noticed that? You come down here every week and you sit in the pews and one of the grown-ups gets to hold the microphone and talk. But Easter is a particularly special day. Yes, sir? Easter is when Jesus rose from the dead. You got it. Amen. Yes, sir.
Do you have any chocolate yet?
Okay, well, we'll get chocolate later. I know we have fudge downstairs. Anyway, what I thought I would do today is to talk to you about who Easter is for. Easter is not just for the grown-ups. I'll get to you in a minute. Okay? Yes, what is it? You didn't eat chocolate? We won't hold that against you, okay? So Easter is a gift from Jesus to everybody, not just the grown-ups and not just the church people, but for everybody. And so I thought that since God's grace is for everybody, and since you people have been so patient 51 weeks of the year listening to the grown-ups talk, I thought for Easter we would shake things up a little bit. And my friend Eric, the computer man, helped me find something where the kids talk about Easter. So for the children's sermon this morning, I'm going to ask you to look at the screen and see what the kids have to say about Easter, okay? Just watch the screen.
Hello. We want to tell you an amazing story. It's about God. He loves us so much, he sent his son Jesus to us so we can be friends with God.
This is our story of Easter. Jesus is really cool. Jesus looked after people.
He did some incredible miracles.
He's basically like Superman, but he's like... He's dressed in different clothes.
Jesus said he was a way for everyone to be friends with God, and some people didn't like that.
One day, Jesus went to Jerusalem
and brought his friends together for a special supper.
Jesus even washed his friends' stinky feet
and taught them something important.
That we should love each other
the same way he loves us.
Jesus said, "Eat this bread and wine and remember me."
And they sang their favorite song.
Later on, Jesus went to a garden to pray.
His friends went too, but they fell asleep. Jesus prayed and talked with God, his Father in heaven. They had a plan together to save all the people in the world.
Then suddenly, soldiers came to arrest Jesus and took him away.
His friends were afraid and ran on.
The leaders asked Jesus, "Are you the Son of God?" And Jesus says, "Yes."
The leaders didn't like that.
The soldiers hurt Jesus and made fun of him.
And they gave him a little hat, it was like spiky to out his head. And they gave him a big heavy cross to carry.
And they pinned him up on his hands and feet.
Some people shouted at Jesus,
"If you really are God's son, then just climb down."
Jesus could have climbed down. He could have made it stop, but he stayed there. Because he loves us, it was all part of the plan.
Then Jesus died.
And Mary and everyone cried.
The sky got really dark. The sun couldn't shine.
Maybe because the barrenness was all in it, making God feel sad.
Jesus' body in a tomb.
And they pushed a huge stone in front of the door so no one could get in.
3 days later, God sent an angel from heaven. When the soldiers saw the angel, they got scared and ran off.
Then the angel rolled the stone away.
Then some of Jesus' friends came to the tomb to wash Jesus' body, but the tomb was empty.
And they saw the shining angel who told them,
"Don't be afraid, Jesus is not here. He is not dead anymore. Jesus is alive again." Friends rushed home to tell everybody.
But Mary stayed a bit longer. She thought the gardener was coming to talk to her.
But it was Jesus.
A few days later, Jesus' friends were all together having dinner. And then Jesus appeared to them. They were a bit scared at first. And then they got very excited. And Jesus explained the plan. That now nothing
not even really bad stuff can separate us from being friends with God.
Hundreds of people saw Jesus before he went up to heaven.
And now we can call heaven home too and be with him when we die.
Jesus is alive!
And he's there in our hearts.
That's our story of Easter. But it's still not the end of the story.
God loves me.
And he loves you.
God loves everybody.
And he wants us to be his friends.
That was a good story, wasn't it? Yeah. And you know what that story shows us? It shows us that even kids can understand the Easter story and share it. So I hope that when you have the opportunity to talk to people about Easter, you'll be able to tell them what it's all about. It's about Jesus and God's plan and loving everybody. Okay? Let's have a prayer together and then we can go downstairs for Children's Church. Dear God, we thank you for Jesus, and we thank you that through Jesus, we can all be friends with God and with each other. We thank you for the Easter miracle and that Jesus, working with you, was able to be a part of the plan and that we are able to be a part of the plan too. Now that God has made it possible for everybody to be friends with God, we can also love and be friends with each other. We thank you for this. Amen.
Thank you. Friends, this is our opportunity to share with one another our joys and concerns and to lift up our prayers and our celebrations to the Lord. So I'll ask Spencer to help me with the microphone and we will celebrate the blessings and raise the concerns of our lives. Thank you. I'll share a joy. Vicki and I are blessed to have our family with us, our three children and our daughter-in-law, or as we say, our four kids. All four of our kids are in the back there. And I know Vicki's a happy mama. She likes having all of her chicks in the same coop. So I'm celebrating family, and I guess a lot of you here today are celebrating family, so that's a wonderful thing. Are there any prayers or praises to be lifted up?
I'm thankful for everybody who could come to Noah's party yesterday. It was a very good time. Thanks to Spence for all his help and everybody who helped me and brought things. It was just a lot of faith gathering and fun.
Yes. Anyone else? Joys or concerns?
A praise for our Christian traditions. It was great to be at sunrise yet again. And there's some irony to being in the cemetery and seeing the sunrise and appreciating what the real reality of the meaning of this holiday is and how brief all of our lives are and how important it is to live out our faith.
Yes. Jean mentioned the service at the cross, the celebration at the cross, which I hear was wonderful.
Yeah, I just want to say about the cross, I think there was over 300 people registered, so that was pretty marvelous. And I always get a kick out of it every time we're up there. there's those buzzards that circle around, and I hear people going, "Oh, look at the eagles! Look at the eagles! Wow!" You know. And but hopefully this cross that's erected up there now, 56 years. This was the 56th anniversary. I hope that cross stands for another 56 years at least. And the people who were responsible for helping us get it together, they came to see it. They thought it was awesome. So thank you.
Thank you, Spence.
It's good to have most of my family in church this morning.
Yeah. Anyone in the back, joys or concerns? All right, let's place ourselves before God and lift up our prayers and our praises. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we thank you for the ministry of your Son Jesus, and we thank you for his presence in our midst. We ask you to be with those who are in need of prayer and healing, especially Bill Purcell, who is battling cancer, JT and family, the Vitero family, Justin's family, and Marie and the Katkowski family. We pray for Dick, who needs health improvement. We pray for the Gerbich family. We ask you to bless and comfort the Sarah family, the Aller family, the Hager family, and we continue our prayers for our brother Carl, who was in hospital. And Lord, we join others in praying to you for world peace. We ask you, Lord, to be with our church, to be with our communities, and to offer traveling mercies and protection to all who are on the roads this holiday weekend. Gracious Father, hear our prayers. Now, friends, I invite you to turn your attention to Rob Ensinger for special music this morning.
Thank you. At this time, I ask our ushers to come forward for the presentation of God's tithes and our offerings. Because we want to see your will done, Lord. Help us to be committed to your service here on earth. We ask these things and ask with these blessings, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture lesson is taken from John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18, and can be found on the screen or in your Bibles in the pews on page 944. Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter then came out with the other disciple, and they went toward the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stopping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying, and the napkin, which had been on his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not know the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stopped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Saying this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom do you seek?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and said to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Here ends the reading of our scripture.
Thank you, Sherry. Easter is a fabulous and an exciting and a wonderful occasion. And yet, sometimes I have the suspicion that those of us in the church feel that it's an old story. We've heard it. It's familiar. We who claim the name Christian are aware of Jesus' ministry and his sacrifice and his resurrection. And I think sometimes we become just a little bit complacent about what it all means. And so I've entitled my brief meditation for this morning, "Good News Never Gets Old." And I want to remind all of us who are Christians that good news never gets old. Jesus went to the cross, was apparently defeated by evil men with evil agendas and intentions, and defeated death and was resurrected into new life. A small example of what I'm attempting to show in Good News Never Gets Old is I have a ministry couple, friends, that serve a church in another area of our district. And if you talk to them, they do not say that they are ministers. I mean, they have undergraduate degrees and master's degrees and a lot of experience. They are well known in certain circles. They have made major contributions to the life of the church and to the kingdom. And yet, if you ask the couple, the wife, her name is Maria, if you ask Maria, "Hi, you know, who are you?" She'll say, "I'm the lucky woman who's married to the handsomest man in the city." And that's how she describes herself. And she describes herself as the woman who's married to the handsomest man in the city to anybody that asks her about herself at any point. And those of us who know Maria and her husband Michael, we laugh, but we also smile, and it's a little bit wistful because we're thinking, wow, you know? What would it be like to be in a married relationship with a woman who consistently referred to you every day to anybody that asked as the handsomest man in the city? You ask Michael, "Hi, what do you, you know, who are you, Michael?" And he says, "I'm the lucky man that married the sweetest woman in the world." And he says it every time. And again, on the one hand, you could kind of wince. You know? And on the other hand, you think, wow, that's a really wonderful way to affirm your wife. It's a wonderful thing. And everybody who knows Michael knows that his self-description is not, "I'm important," or "I do good things," or "I'm talented in certain areas." His self-descriptor is, "I'm married to that wonderful lady over there." It's a good blessing. I'm going to talk out of school here just a little bit, but when I go to
breakfast at the B&C restaurant, I have occasionally listened to conversation at the table. And it has come up once or twice that there are men who are here this morning who, let's just say, married out of their weight class. There are people who married above themselves. And just so you know, they know it. I myself am somebody who married out of my caliber. I reached higher than I thought I could achieve, and I married a good woman. And now she doesn't go around introducing herself as married to the handsomest man in the city. That would be silly. But she does say positive things about me, and I appreciate it. And I hope I say positive things about her, because I certainly appreciate her. Now, having said all that, good news doesn't get old. People who love and affirm each other can love and affirm each other on a regular basis, and it doesn't get old. When my friend says, I'm married to the handsomest man in the city, he doesn't say, I wish you'd stop saying that. He just kind of chuckles and shakes his head. But I think he's pleased. And when he says he's married to the sweetest woman in the world, she doesn't say, oh, for goodness sake, will you get rid of that old chestnut? She appreciates it. And so on Easter, when we hear what is referred to as the old, old story, yes, it is familiar. Yes, we know the nuances of the story. We know the chronology of Jesus' passion and resurrection. In fact, the kids know it. They were on the video today. But it doesn't get old. Jesus loved each and every one of us so much that he went to the cross and stayed on the cross when he had the power to come down from that cross. And he did it because he loved each and every one of us to the point of a very painful death and his resurrection. And so I say to you this morning that even if it should happen that in your mind the Easter story is familiar, even if the Easter story doesn't have the same aha moment that it might have had when you first realized that Jesus died for you, even if we have patterns and traditions and ways of behavior that seem old, the love that Jesus Christ demonstrated for each of us on the cross is new every day. That's why I love the sunrise service. I love sunrise services in all the churches I've ever served, because even though the love of God for humanity is eternal, that love is demonstrated anew every day when we see the sun rise. And every day, Jesus finds new ways to say that he loves us, he cares for us, and he is present in the midst of our lives. And so I pray that on this Easter holiday, we will all celebrate that Christ, rather than doing an old thing or a familiar thing or something that we've already embraced, let's celebrate that God loved us so much that he gave us his son, and Jesus loved us so much that he willingly set his face to the cross and endured his passion so that he could be with us alive forevermore. May you be blessed by this proclamation of God's holy word. Amen. Friends, we prepare for the Eucharistic feast, and as we do so, I invite you to see the responses as they appear on the screen. The ushers will be passing the elements among you in the pews. We'll pass the bread, and we will consume the bread together. We will pass the juice. We will consume the juice together, and then the ushers, as they come back down the aisle, will receive the empties. And so I say to you, as we gather together this day, that as we prepare for the Eucharistic celebration, this is an open table. This is the Lord's table.
It is open to all who believe and will receive. This is not a United Methodist table. It's not a Clark's Grove table. It's certainly not my table. This is the Lord's table, and all are welcome. My friends, may Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord. Let us give our full thanks to the Holy One.
It is right, good, and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give our thanks to you, who has raised Christ from the dead, and who has given us the promise of new life in his name. We give you thanks for the prophets and apostles, for the disciples who ran to see the empty tomb, for the faith and testimony of Mary Magdalene, and for the women and men of every age who have witnessed to the power of the risen Christ for healing, forgiveness, and new life.
And so, with your creatures on earth and all the heavenly chorus, we praise your name and join their unending hymn of praise, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, Lord, and holy is your Son, Jesus Christ, who in life brought healing and freedom to all who were oppressed, and who even in death upon the cross forgave his enemies, and who rose from the dead and lives in us today. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup. He offered thanks and gave it to the disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my life in the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit, God, upon us and all these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may in turn be the body of Christ for all who yearn for new life. God of newness and mystery, God of wonder and love, God of resurrection and new life, we praise your name and rejoice in the rich and eternal life we have in you. Amen. And now, friends, I invite the ushers to come forward. And we will receive the elements that the Lord has provided for us. My friends, take and eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. My friends, take a drink. This is the blood of Christ shed for you and your salvation. I'll ask the ushers to go back up and receive the empties. Friends, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, friends, I invite you to look within your heart and to celebrate the new thing that Jesus is doing in your life through his Spirit being active within you and within the people around you. It is possible daily to see Christ in the eyes and in the hearts of the Christians that we interact with. May you be blessed by the presence of Christ this day. Amen. I invite you to rise as you are able in body or spirit to sing our closing hymn, He Lives. Join me in a unison prayer of dismissal. Let us pray together. With Mary and the disciples and all those who live in Christ, let us rejoice that we have seen our Savior, who is not dead but lives, in the love of our Creator, in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ,
and in the power of the Holy Spirit,
let us go forth to love and serve the world.
Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen.
My friends, we are dismissed. May God be with you until we meet again.